Hello and welcome to the workshop, the onboarding workshop, Workflows. With this presentation, we would like to give you an introduction into general concepts of workflows in the platform Material Digital. My name is Timmann Hicke. I am a group head at the Max-Planck-Institut für Eisenforschung in Düsseldorf, and I'm representing here the workflow team of Platform Material Digital, which is currently formed by the players given with the logos down here. What you want to achieve with the platform is to provide and to establish standards for communication protocols. Let me first start with the example of power supply, where such kind of protocols are already well established. And everybody, all stakeholders in the network are actually adapted to these standards. So standards are as given here, that's well known to you. And the standards apply between different customers as well as within certain institutions or companies. Of course, there are certain devices where there may be some other kind of power standards like low voltage applications, but between different devices within an institution, you usually have standardized systems. In principle, there is a chance also to define your own standard in your company or your research institute for power supply and power connection. And maybe that's for some applications that's even more suitable. However, that makes it difficult to connect other devices from the market. So think about a personal computer. What you as a company would like to do is to buy such a computer on the market and connect it and plug it in, it should work automatically, without any need to have first some transformation of power from one system to the other. And that's something that we would like to achieve in a similar way also for workflows and software tools. We would like to give a company with an industrial background the chance to go on the market, which is the materials research community, and take certain software tools, certain ways of established or just newly digested methods of data management, of data handling, and incorporate them into this running system of the company without the need of knowing details for installing the software, without the need of knowing details of input files and output files, without the need of getting a long training to how to run the software, but just to plug it in and make it available for the company to increase the portfolio of activities of this company or a research institute. That's by no way straightforward to achieve. Yeah, in particular material science, because we are facing a multi-scale approach, a multi-scale character of materials. We are facing a large diversity of different materials classes. And it goes along with a variety of codes for computer simulation, as well as software applications for devices, device drivers as well, which are often incompatible, handle incompatible data formats and are often not very well documented. And it means for every software tool, basically you need an expert which is able to run this tool. And that is a particular challenge for companies which cannot hire a variety of different experts to make sure that they can use all these different tools. Our answer to this is we would need an environment, a workflow infrastructure, which goes with an intuitive web interface, which allows you to set up these different data structures, which you need to run the different codes. But these codes live in a software container, Docker container would be a technical term, in a well-defined environment. You as a user just need to make sure you have this environment available, but don't need to understand all the technical details of installing and running the codes individually. This ensures interoperability, well-defined interfaces to codes and drivers, and it ensures automation. The advantage is that then you can also easily go towards advanced, sophisticated analysis tools like machine learning, which can then be applied to these kind of outcomes from different software solutions. Yeah, so the underlying idea is that whenever you run a workflow in such a framework, you usually follow a generic set of different steps. So you start with a materials model, which you want to explore by setting up various projects. And the projects require some generic input. But to run the different tools, the generic input needs to be translated into a code-specific input file. Then you start your tool and you get some code-specific output file, which you have to kind of translate again to some generic output. You need to do job validation, data collection analysis, all these different kind of aspects that you do when you process data. But typically nowadays that's done, these kind of intermediate steps here, it's done by some intransparent scripts or manual steps even, yeah? Some shell scripts which read out data and then you copy them perhaps by hand into some Excel table to collect them and reorder them and run some analysis and then you take another tool for visualization. And this kind of process is often not very transparent even for scientists. So one PhD is setting up for his purposes, for his PhD thesis, probably rather advanced workflow, but another student would not be able to follow the same workflow as well. In this way, we need improvement here, and one improvement is the connection to ontologies, which allows that these different workflows are following the knowledge which we know from graph databases. And we need also from the infrastructure point of view, a given environment which allows an automation of these kind of workflows. And this way, the user basically would need access to the workflows via transparent web interface and runs the individual steps for setting up the project and for validating the project. But what is happening here, all these steps in between should be taken over by the workflow environment system. This applies to computational simulations in the same way as to experiments, where also you have typically established workflows, but intransparent workflows, which are not documented and ended in a way that another scientist could take them over. And again, this is also something which you want to improve with the environment of Platform Material Digital. There are already on the market various kind of workflow environments which take care of these kind of aspects. And all of them somehow try to a certain extent to combine on the one hand this kind of software layer, this software framework of connecting to different tools, of running then simulation protocols and handling the jobs also in high performance computing infrastructures. There is the issue of distributing workflows and the community connected to compute resources and also the storage. Within Platform Material Digital, we in particular supporting here Pyren and SimStack, or other way around, Pyren SimStack should support you in order to run workflows in a standardized way. I will come back to Pyren and SimStack in the last part of my presentation. Let me now just collect a few more ideas what we need to take care of when handling with these kind of workflow systems, in particular in the PMD. First of all, on the positive side, what are the advantages of using workflow environments? I mentioned before, one advantage we want to achieve is that we have a user-friendly interface. That's the interface here for Pyren and for Semstack. You will get more used to it throughout this workshop. The other advantage is that we want to achieve standardized calculation methods. We want to make them reproducible by following certain standards and reliable. Within these kinds of calculation methods, we want to combine different software tools without the need for the user to know all the details of the individual tools. And making these simulations standardized and within a given environment, we also ensure a proper documentation of the individual steps. Documentation, which is also necessary for publication. So all the different steps getting from raw data to the published figure should be represented by the workflow protocols, which is in the case of Semstack, a Veno or a combination of Venos, and in case of Pyren, a set of Jupyter notebooks. Technical issues are the connection to and automized connection to storage and to high performance computing. And I mentioned the connection to knowledge graphs, means ontologies. Platform Material Digital pushes forward the concept of decentralized data storage. So there may be various flavors of server involved, some of them more devoted to computation resources, some perhaps more to databases or as a distribution for apps. But all of them should have at least the same kind of software layer. We want to ensure with this concept that the data remain where they are. The data remain on the servers where they have been created, but the access to the data can be shared. Doesn't have to be shared. That concept doesn't mean that everything is open access, but there's the potential to share access to the data. What does it mean in practice? Let me just explain this for one material science example. That's here atom probe tomography, for instance. That's a typical data set from atom probe tomography here for high strength steel. And maybe you are interested in determining short range order on these kind of materials. Short range order is related to the strength, to the hardening of the material. So you can do this on your own server with your own data because you have the equipment for atom probe tomography and you know how to analyze this data. You know which kind of protocols you need in order to get your raw data and just the number we are interested in, like a short range order parameter. However, these kind of experiments are expensive and you have then only a few samples perhaps for which you can get data. Other samples may have been investigated by other colleagues in other institutes. There may be also companies who perform atom probe tomography. There may be also other research institutes which have data. And now you would like to make use of these other data as well. With the company, the difficulties is you are not allowed to enter their system. They are not allowed to share all their data with you. So there is a certain kind of barrier here. Also for the other research institutes, such a sample, a complete set of data, maybe easily terabyte, which you don't want to transfer from one server to the other. But what you could do is now to have your well-defined simulation workflow and you run it on the server And this gives rise to some number which needs to be returned. And this may be something which is possible to do return aggregated data also for the company if you have a bilateral agreement with them or also with your other research colleagues in another research institute. Again, it's much easier to transfer just the resulting number instead of the full set of raw data. And in this way, you can then get from different resources your aggregated data and handle them in some kind of table format and make statistics and analysis of a much larger set of data as if you would just rely on your own sample. And that you can make use of the other data, once again, that's ensured by the fact that they have a similar comparable software framework. One aspect I've mentioned is the connection to ontologies. There was an ontology onboarding workshop 2 weeks ago. Of course, the idea is to bring these concepts of ontologies and workflows together. At the moment, we have here different levels of connection in mind. One possibility is to consider an ontology as a data store, and then a workflow, which consists of a well-documented set of process steps or chain of process steps to handle data for a specific problem in order to deliver a particular set of outputs. Yeah, you need input data and you get output data. This can be done in connection with ontology by a Sparkle query. You get your data by a Sparkle query from your ontology, then you handle the data, and then you provide the output data back into the ontology. You can also think about some more knowledge base of exchange. So a workflow may consist of various steps these steps need to be completely represented in your workflow in order to ensure that you get an accurate result at the end. And you can then double check with your ontology if the ontology also contains the full set of information which you require to get from one data point to the other data point. Another way of looking at this is that you use the ontology the knowledge of the ontology about what is input and output of a certain process in order to set up actually your workflow. So it means, for instance, you extract from a stress strain curve elastic modulus and this is an information which is stored into your ontology that the elastic modulus is a result of a stress strain curve. And then you can, in your workflow, choose those tools which provide this connection with the stress strain curve and elastic modulus in order to set up your workflow. At the end, what we want to achieve is that we have an interoperability of software tools via the ontology. The software tools need to be therefore connected to your workflow environment. Again, here this can be done in various levels, and this will be deepened and demonstrated with examples in the hands-on session. So I can be short here. We have on the lowest level the script-based jobs. That means the workflow starts a certain Python script, for instance, and this Python script is responsible for handling the connection to certain software tools. But a more advanced way of getting software integrated is by having really workflow classes or workflow components within your workflow environment. What this means will be explained later. Then this can be also represented by a graphical interface. And at the end, what I would like to achieve again is an interoperable workflow and following certain community standards. Yeah. A workflow usually consists of various steps, and these different steps can also be represented in the or implemented in your environment differently. So you can combine a level A implementation with a level B implementation, for instance. And the idea is that you gradually increase the level of implementation, starting with some low level implementation, and then step by step, when you establish your workflow more, or when it's getting more established, then you also would like to go to a deeper integration level in the environment. Getting a workflow more established also means you would like to distribute it, to share it with your colleagues. For this, we provide an app store for workflows next to an additional app store, which we provide for software packages. So these software packages we handle with Docker container and Docker container images, which can be shared. But then let's now focus on the workflows. For this, we have for the discovery of workflows, this PMT workflow store, given this address. And this basically connects them to repositories and establishes systems like GitHub and GitLab. But these repositories usually don't allow you to order your workflows, to make them searchable, to make some queries for designated workflows. So that's taken care of by the PMD workflow store. Still, what we need is a bit of a standardized way of how workflows should be incorporated into repositories. So we include here YAML files, which define the dependencies of different software tools which you need in order to run your workflow. Here we favor the usage of Conda and Conda packaging. Conda is a way of installing scientific software, and rather established a way, I should say. So you have, like in an app store, a certain channel which takes care of the technical implementation. So the channel we are, at least for Pyren, using at the moment is Conda Forge. And all the tools in Conda Forge are then linked to a certain Python version, and all the dependencies of the packages are taken care of such that you can, independent of your operating system, just with one command line basically install what you need. The Conda channel, Conda Forge, existed already longer than the PMD with certain tools integrated at this time. And we have added Pyren to this together with a lot of tools for atomistic simulations, which are needed at our institute at Max Planck. But we realized then that having here such a complete or rather extended class set of tools together, the community got more and more interested in this Conda channel, and many other groups have meanwhile added further tools to this community channel. And it's really a community effort to have here rather large set of tools now available for which are the dependencies between these tools well defined. Going back to this slide, so what we will also here always ask you to do when you add your workflow to the store is to add another file which describes all the metadata of your workflow to make your workflow easier searchable and findable. In this way, to complete the information which is then provided in the App Store. Well, I should mention here that by using open access channels like Conda Forge, we can also support currently only open access software, but this does not mean that commercial software cannot run in the system. It just means that you cannot distribute this as part of a software package. We need to run a commercial software under your own license on your own software, but it can of course be integrated into your workflow. So now towards the end, I would like to briefly comment on the two workflow systems we are using in the platform Material Digital at the moment. That's on the one hand, Jupyter, the Jupyter-based system Pyron. Pyron has been developed by Max Planck Institute for Eisenforschung, that's why IREN, provides as a user-friendly interface this Jupyter Notebooks, or can be executed in Jupyter Lab. So we use an established system for the machine-human interaction. Jupyter Labs allows you to handle at the same time your variety of different projects, databases, visualization, as well as analysis tools. We provide at the moment different modules of Pyron, starting with a basic module. Then comes Pyron Atomistics. I mentioned that from our background, Max Planck Institute for Eisenforschung, we are mainly interested in a large set of different, just a selection, atomistic tools, which we have combined into one Docker image, one software environment for atomistic simulations. But we are also pushing forward developments and for continuum simulation. And if you're basically taking care of two tools at the moment, it's for experimental workflows. And so we have software environments in terms of Docker images available also from Continuum and for experiment. I should also mention that we are, in addition to this kind of Jupyter Python-based interface, we're just a bit more command line interaction between the user and the machine, pushing forward graphical user interfaces, which allow you to go through your projects and data, as well as executing completely well predefined workflows without requirement to actually give in Python commands. But we see also an advantage of giving Python commands in the sense that you can very interactively execute your workflow and modify your workflow, analyze intermediate steps. This for a large variety of different applications. Just a few screenshots here. That's a typical screenshot for an experimental workflow. Analysis of transmission electron microscopy data. I don't have the time now to go into details. I just would like to give you a few impressions. Here it's atomistic workflow, that's the calculation of the thermal expansion coefficient for a material. And so you set up your system by a few steps which are given here. You can directly visualize the structure, see if this is a structure you are intending to look at or if you still want to modify it. So you can interact with your workflow. And then we go towards harmonic approximation by first minimizing the structure, the energy of the structure, and then in addition, as the next step, perform Fonon calculations with a few post-processing steps in order then to get something like free energies as a function of lattice constant for different temperatures. And from this, you get the thermal expansion. Yeah, what I would like to convey here is that you just have a few intermediate steps to get from your starting structure to your final results. The steps are interactive, so you can modify individual steps in the way you want and you need it. can modify here your materials concept and your individual steps. You can modify the composition or whatever you think is necessary. You can rather easily reproduce what somebody else has done earlier, because it's all in the same notebook, and it's usually, that depends of course also on the user, very nice documented, and so that makes it easy for somebody else to read what your predecessor has done. Last example I wanted to show for Pyron is Phoenix. Phoenix is integrated already as a job class, that some of the features of Phoenix are available. I should mention Phoenix is a code for performing finite element simulations. Again, no need or no time for details, but just let me show you an example. Let's take the example of a membrane, two-dimensional circular membrane, which is subject to an external load. And you would like to calculate this deflection of this membrane. That means you need to solve a differential equation for a certain set of parameters. That's basically the kind of structure of the workflow then in Pyron. So you need to set up a job, which is now a Phoenix job, define a certain execution parameters, but also physical parameters like the beta here and your R0 here. You would have to determine your experimental your expression for the differential equation, your boundary conditions, and then you run the job. And you can do this by modifying different your parameters and getting your different responses of your deflection of the membrane. The same kind of job can also, of course, be performed, or the same kind of workflow can be performed in SimStack. SimStack is another environment for executing workflows. With the material science, which enters here, is the same one, but the way it's represented to the user is a different one. So here, the individual steps are here represented in terms of what's called VNOs. This will be explained later. One VNO is this Phoenix VNO, and to make it user-friendly for a given workflow, the number of parameters that is reduced to those parameters which are really relevant for the evaluation, that's done by the Phoenix experts to limit your interfaces to a few input lines relevant for your workflow. And again, for the example of this circular membrane, you can by drag and drop need to put together these kind of different steps of the workflow. Phoenix is the central one. There are some data analysis, and then you want to loop over different model parameters and get a similar evaluation of your results as I've shown it for you for Pyron. But the approach is a different one. It's more graphical dominated with a limitation on purpose of the number of interplay parameters you have, such that you really focus on the workflow you are interested in. And it's not so interactive and command line driven or Python programming driven as it's in Pyron. But Pyron gives you the flexibility to on the fly modify your workflow and modify the materials model you want to apply. That brings me to the end. I would like to use the last slides or last couple of slides to speak a bit about how we see the interaction within this topic of workflows. That means how you can interact with the already existing workflow team in the platform Material Digital. So what do we expect from you? We expect your experience and your feedback. You may have already experience with workflow systems, with app stores, with way of sharing your software solutions. In particular, it would be interesting if you have some industrial perspective, if you have already some ideas or experiences with combining ontology with workflows, or you have experiences in a certain specific field of material science like machine learning, and would like to incorporate this kind of background into the framework. In particular, this applies also to experimental workflows, for which we have not so many examples so far in the platform, and which should definitely become a substantial part of also the workflow systems. This includes keywords like lab books and also device software, which need to be integrated. But you also are experts in certain domains of material science. You are experts for certain software tools, and you should become our multipliers that whatever is done in the PMT is adapted to your community, such as it's of use for your community, and that means not only for you, but also for others in the field. What we can offer is to give the framework for this kind of exchange, yeah, for the scientific discussions. So we have a workflow group, and you are welcome to join this workflow group. We will provide further workshops and trainings for using SimStack and Pyren, but I also believe that we need bilateral interactions. So we would like to provide some support how you can integrate your software tools into the environments. That needs to be collaborative, but at least for the first tool, we should here really give some guideline and help. Not for all of you at the same time, but perhaps within the next 6 months. And we will also support you by distributing your workflow solutions. That means increase the outreach of your activities. But whatever you have done can also be used by others and increase your visibility of what you have done. Yeah, so at the end, with all this domain or expertise which you bring in, we would like to extend the concepts which we have here introduced at the beginning of having communication protocols between a few players to something like a full city of materials research. So where you bring in your domain expertise and you build your building of digital materials science and platform material digital, but would appreciate if you do it according to our jointly developed communication protocols that also other groups and other even research fields maybe benefit from your activities, and that we have a larger activity where all of us can benefit from one another. Final slide is a list of links where you can, for further reading, for getting further information. I keep this for you to read and would like to end with summarizing here again. We are thinking here about a joint activity. We would like to jointly develop a platform for structured, decentralized handling of data and workflows. And we would like to push also the idea that data and workflows belong together as one unity. To have this kind of joint platform, we need to follow some guidelines, which are also some important points are listed here again. We will start with some software environments supported so far. These are Pyren and SimStack. And we will also push forward this connection to ontologies to bring to two main, roots of activities in the platform material digital more and more together. With this, I'm at the end, and I thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward, or as you should say, we as a team of workflow people are looking forward to interacting with you and making this community effort towards building up something together. Thank you very much.